The Alabama Farmers Federation and the Alabama Farmers Cooperative proudly present Simply Southern with your hosts, Jim Allen and Mary Johnson.
Hello and thanks for joining us today for Simply Southern. I'm Jim Allen.
And I'm Mary Johnson. Coming up on today's show, you'll meet an Alabama Marine who's trying to save his fellow veterans from their nightmares and themselves.
I want to save people from taking their own life, and I want to show them the worst day on earth is still a great day.
Although Alabama received abundant rains in January, many farmers say they're still feeling the effects of last year's drought.
If we don't receive a lot more rain between now and say the end of April, we have that 2 or 3 week dry spell that we always have in May or June. We'll be in worse shape quicker than we were last year.
Plus, Sydney Phelps of Bonnie Plants will be showing us how to dry herbs from your backyard garden so you can use them in the kitchen.
But to get us started, we asked, you answered, and now the votes have been counted. We're headed to the place that our viewers voted the best milkshake in Alabama.
The way they do their shakes, the way they do everything is just excellent.
What we eat, what we wear, it all starts somewhere. And if it's good, it usually starts with a farmer. And that somewhere is right here in Alabama. In a field, in a barn, on a tractor. Right now, there's a farmer starting something good for all of us. And it all starts right here in Alabama.
What one thing can you say about your local quality co-op store? You can trust us. You get what you need for your farm, for your lawn and garden, and the safest products for your pets. We're locally owned and operated, and you can trust that we care about our community and the people in it. So if you're a raised bed gardener, a rose gardener, or if you farm hundreds of acres, the Quality Co-op Store has exactly what you need to get the job done. All this plus friendly, knowledgeable advice. Your Quality Co-op Store. There's one near you.
Last year, we started a Facebook contest among our viewers to find Alabama's best milkshake. After tabulating the thousands of votes, y'all didn't disappoint with your chosen winner, Mrs. Story's Dairy Bar in Opelika.
The parking lot is small, but customers' appetites are large when they stop at Mrs. Story's Dairy Bar. For 6 decades, it's been the place locals and visitors come for a chili dog and what's now been voted Alabama's best milkshake.
I would say I've been coming here even before I moved here to Opelika, and I've been here now about 25 years.
I've been coming since the inception of May 1952. People didn't eat out that much, but they did come for ice cream.
I've gotten a hot dog and a strawberry shake once a week for 33 years.
I can remember my parents bringing me here when I was barely walking. I've had milkshakes everywhere, and this is the best milkshake in Alabama, no question.
Listen, the way they do their shakes, the way they do everything is just excellent, and I think Mrs. Store is the epitome of a local, home-owned, home-operated business.
May of this year marks 65 years in business for Mrs. Story's Dairy Bar. It opened in 1952 as a Dairy Delight, but changed to its current name when the franchise contract ran out. The menu has always been rather simple, featuring hot dogs with fix-ins and the famous milkshakes. Plus, the restaurant has always been owned by members of the same family.
My grandmother, this was her business. Her husband built it for her 65 years ago. She managed the business, and when she retired, my mother purchased it, and my mother owned it. And when she retired 19 years ago, me and my husband purchased it, and so we're third generation.
Rhonda's mother, Cora Reams, was the second generation to own and operate the business.
I'm so very proud to be a part of this family that started this 65 years ago, and it has continued. And when my son-in-law retires, my grandson plans to buy the business, so it will keep going. We have a good rapport with our customers.
And it's the relationships they have with customers that help them win Simply Southern TV's Facebook contest for Alabama's Best Milkshake. As winners, the family business received a cash prize and plaque sponsored by the Southeast United Dairy Industry Association, or SUDA. While everyone in the community seems to have their favorite milkshake, we decided to choose a best of the best milkshake with sponsors from SUDA. After trying five of their top sellers, the best was...
I think I have to go with the chocolate walnut as well. So that might be our best overall.
There,
but there's not a loser in this group. There's a lot of close second places.
For Lee County dairy farmer and SUDA representative Daryl Rankins, visiting Mrs. Story's Dairy Bar was like a step back in time.
My grandfather would say, "All right, let's load up. We're going to town." And we knew what that meant. We were going to a place just like this where I grew up in Illinois. It's not a corporate chain. There's not a Mrs. Story's Dairy Bar in every town in America. This is sort of a unique little place.
So what's their secret to making a great milkshake at Mrs. Story's?
We use whole milk, we use fruit, and then we use the ice cream. So it's not something that's, the ingredients is put into a machine that comes out frozen. It's actually made on an old-timey milkshake machine, so I think that makes the difference.
With quality products, hard work, and superior customer service, it's likely Alabamians can find the state's best milkshake in Opelika for many years to come.
I just want to thank the community, you know, for supporting us all these years, and God has been good. He's blessed many families by this business. There's just nothing like having a good old Miss Story's milkshake.
The others at the top of the Facebook contest were Cardinal Drive-In in Florence, Peach Park in Clanton, and Mel's Dairy Dream in Monroeville.
That sounds like a really tasty trip, Mary. Why wasn't I invited? You know, I didn't get this Alfred Hitchcock profile from eating rice cakes.
You make a good point, but maybe you can be part of the next Facebook contest.
Well, I hope I can. What will that be?
You'll have to check our Facebook page. We're actually going to let our viewers vote on what they want us to do next. So that poll will be up today.
Oh, that's cool. Coming up next on Simply Southern, we're visiting a U.S. Marine who's using his land and lessons from his own life to help other members of the military.
We all have busy lives. When my customers have a claim, I want to help them get things back to normal as quickly as possible. There's no better claim service out there, and that's one of the reasons I work for Alpha Insurance. And our Alpha To Go app is just one way we make it easy to get that service. Anytime, anywhere.
For the best agents in the business, call Alpha.
Support healthy food from local farmers by purchasing a Farming Feeds Alabama license plate. The tag funds education and promotion efforts, including Ag in the Classroom, agricultural scholarships, and youth programs. Get your Ag tag today.
Today's farming operation is more complex than ever before, with precision agriculture becoming an integral piece to farm management. AccuField provides precision agriculture technologies and site-specific management capabilities in a simplified and interactive format, helping you put all the pieces of the farming puzzle together. For more information, visit us at www.acufield.com.
Alabama soybean farmers help fuel the state's economy. Soybeans are used to make clean, renewable biodiesel and are a key ingredient in feed for poultry, catfish, and livestock. Soybeans are used in dozens of products we use every day. But best of all, soybean farmers generate $258 million and more than 4,000 jobs for Alabama's economy, all while helping conserve our natural resources. Explore the power of soy.
Members of the military face horrific battles in the fight to protect our country. But for many, it's the interior battles they face when they return to American soil that can be the deadliest. Macon County native and Marine Corps Major Lee Stuckey knows this all too well. After facing his own battle with PTSD, he's now helping other veterans heal through hunting. Kevin Worthington has more on the AHERO Foundation.
After 12 years of active service with 2.5 years fighting in Iraq, Marine Corps Major Lee Stuckey returned to the U.S. as a wounded veteran and was ready to take his own life.
One night I went to shoot myself, and my mom called my cell phone as I was pulling the trigger on my Glock, and she saved my life. And at that moment, She was my one call away, and she saved my life. So at that point, I found a calling to go out and tell people my story and to tell them that, you know, I almost made a permanent decision, and it was a bad one.
A chance encounter at a Buckmasters Expo in Montgomery led Stuckey to develop AHERO Farm, which stands for America's Heroes Enjoying Recreation Outdoors. During hunting season, Stuckey invites veterans from across the U.S. to participate in hunts, the largest of which takes place at his Macon County farm during deer season. The camaraderie and distraction these men find out in the woods is welcome. But Major Stuckey points out the most important thing is what doesn't happen when they get back home.
I want to save people's lives. That's really what this is about. I want to save people from taking their own life, and I want to show them the worst day on earth is still a great day.
Suicide rates among U.S. veterans are alarming. Studies estimate that 22 veterans commit suicide every day. But Stuckey's committed to changing those stats.
We brought in about 1,000 veterans in 6 years. And to have a screen porch in Alabama, in Macon County, and to have history books sit on the porch with me and have screen porch therapy is what we call it. I've had 5 or 6 Marines out here that have literally lost their life in war, were resuscitated and came back. And they sat on the porch and spent time with us in Macon County. And you can't, those are my celebrities.
Stuckey's passion for this project is contagious. His friend and fellow Marine Corporal Lex McMahon is one of 5 volunteers who make up the AHERO board.
They're similarly situated, they understand one another, and then they open up and they begin to heal one another. It's very cathartic and therapeutic. I feel I'm made a better person by being exposed to all these amazing American heroes and all the people who from the communities that support everybody. And that to me is like some of the untold story, is that the community really rallies together and helps to lift up these young men and women who sacrifice so much for our country.
Veterans don't pay a dime for any part of the trip or the hunt. AHERO covers everything from airfare and food to lodging and deer processing. But it takes monetary and material donations from the community to succeed. Home builder Kirby Cadell is one member of the Shorter community who opens his home and land to the veterans for lodging and hunting.
Really, I hope when they leave, they have a good feeling about themselves. And if they ever needed some help, all they got to do is call. And there's been a couple of times where we have had a wounded veteran actually call us and say, hey, I'm coming through, can I come by? And he came by and spent the night, and Lee told us later, you know, we think it saved his life. I can't imagine what they go through. Just cannot imagine. And so if there's some way we can help them, we need to do it.
Stuckey says it's support from people like Cadell that makes AHERO feel like one big family.
This is a family organization. Nobody gets paid. We do it because we love it. And if a veteran or if a landowner or a person wants to get involved and be a part of the family, they just go to aherousa.com and they can register. You can't imagine what it feels like to leave this place after a weekend. Having a perfect stranger on Thursday meet you and on Sunday having them tear up because they don't want to leave. Truly a family experience.
For Simply Southern, I'm Kevin Worthington.
Find out how you can join the AHERO community by visiting aherousa.com. The next big project they've got going on there is building a lodge that will house 30 veterans at a time.
I know that they're really looking forward to getting that funded and built, because the fellowship there at the hunting lodge is just as important as anything else.
It means a lot.
When Simply Southern continues, we'll see how well farmers are recovering from last year's historic drought.
One out of 4 Alabama residents have benefited from the Alabama Cooperative Extension System. Last year, Master Gardener Managed Gardens donated $150,000 worth of fruits and vegetables to food banks, and over 25,000 young people developed math, science, technology, and engineering skills through 4-H. Now what we want to know is, how can we help you?
Alabama wheat and feed grain farmers grow food, fuel, and freedom.
Their harvest helps feed Alabama's multi-million dollar livestock, catfish, and poultry industries while reducing America's dependence on foreign countries for energy and food. By combining their strength with farmers of other commodities, feed grain growers are fueling the economic growth of Alabama communities.
Support healthy food from local farmers by purchasing a Farming Feeds Alabama license plate. The tag funds education and promotion efforts, including Ag in the Classroom, agricultural scholarships, and youth programs. Get your Ag tag today.
Nothing brings the family together like U.S. farm-raised catfish. American catfish farmers are dedicated to producing a premium, healthy catfish with a consistently mild, sweet flavor. Because we take as much pride in our work as you do in your cooking. From our family farms to your family's table, you can be sure you're getting the highest quality fish. Because your family deserves the best. U.S. farm-raised catfish.
Many parts of Alabama experienced record-setting drought in the summer of 2016. Crops withered in the fields, and cattle producers, who normally reserve hay for the winter, were forced to feed their animals hay months ahead of schedule. While 2017 started with above-average rainfall, farmers say the effects of the drought continue. Here once again is Kevin Worthington.
Last summer was historic, and it was historically bad.
Ben Haynes has lived on his family's Coleman County farm all his life, and he says he's never seen conditions as bad as when drought gripped much of Alabama last summer.
We bought all the hay that we could buy locally, and that's a pretty big deal for us. I'm 38, been a part of the farm ever since I was born, and we've never bought hay.
Ben says many of their farm ponds dried up, and they were forced to haul thousands of gallons of water just so their cattle would have something to drink. He says that was not only a lot of work, it was expensive.
Even in the wintertime, they're going to drink 20 to 30 gallons per head per day, a mature cow. So they could do away with a lot of water in a hurry, a lot.
While last summer may have seemed like a curse, weather this winter has been more of a blessing. A combination of above-average rain and warmer-than-normal temperatures has helped his pastures, but Ben says they're still not in good shape.
You know, these little darker green patches, that's fescue, and that's good. These brown spots and light green spots, you know, those are spots where there was fescue that there's not fescue anymore, and it's either occupied by nothing or being filled in with winter weeds. And those are weeds because cattle won't eat them. And if they do eat them, they're not getting any value from them nutritionally. So those bare spots and light green spots are not good.
Ben says he's still feeling the effects of the drought in other areas as well. In spite of abundant rain, water for his cattle remains a concern.
We still got a few ponds that have not filled up, and that's a little concerning. We filled most everything up in January. We had a couple of different weeks that were pretty rainy, maybe 4 or 5 inches this week and 3 or 4 in another week. That filled up most ponds. All the creeks are running as of now, so that's a blessing. That's great. We still got a couple that are not full, though, and that's a little worrying.
Ben says another big concern is the body condition of his cattle. Most of his cows were already pregnant when the worst conditions hit last year, so he's had a good crop of calves this year. He worries about next year's crop, though.
Potentially the problem that it's going to present from a reproductive standpoint, again, maybe not this year, but next year. Lower conception rates, lower pregnancy rates, which means fewer calves, which means fewer calves to sell, which means fewer dollars.
Of course, this is not the first time farmers have dealt with a severe lack of rain. Most recently, farms were parched in 2006 and 2007. Before that, it was 1999 and 2000. And Ben says he's certain it'll happen again in the future. But the important thing is that farmers prepare themselves and their operations both financially and spiritually.
Where we farm, we're not really in an area suitable for irrigation. So we're dependent on rain. And in that, we're dependent on God. We gotta have faith. If we didn't have faith, we wouldn't be doing what we're doing. God's gonna take care of us, and He's gonna give us what we need. We believe that. I believe that.
For Simply Southern, I'm Kevin Worthington.
Fall weather conditions were too dry for many grain producers to get winter wheat crops planted on time, and they're concerned about having subsoil moisture replenished in time to plant spring crops. Farmers say weather is always a big question, but they're particularly concerned this year about low prices for their crops. When Simply Southern continues, Sydney Phelps from Bonnie Plants will be showing us how to dry herbs from your backyard garden so you can use them in the kitchen.
When AJ was born with a heart defect, we practically lived at the hospital. We weren't prepared for that. My Alpha customers, my Alpha family made sure we had everything we needed. Now I'm even more motivated to help take care of them. Who I am fits what I do. I am Alpha.
For the best agents in the business, call Alpha.
There's nothing quite like sitting down to a home-cooked meal with fresh vegetables from the garden. With Bonnie Plants from your local quality co-op store, you can enjoy the freshest vegetables right from your own backyard. And no matter if you're a raised bed gardener, a rose gardener, or if you farm hundreds of acres, your quality co-op store has exactly what you need to get the most out of your plants. You'll always find what you need, plus friendly, knowledgeable advice at your local quality co-op store. There's one near you.
We believe a plant should be more than a plant. This one is. It's all you need for your garden to succeed. Because it's a Bonnie plant. It represents hundreds of varieties of Bonnie's quality veggies and herbs. But more, it's from generations of Bonnie people who are passionate about sharing their love of gardening with you. Look for this little Bonnie plant and a whole family of plants like it in your garden center. Bonnie plants. So you'll know how to grow.
Hey folks, Sydney Phelps here with Bonnie Plants. Today I want to talk about drying herbs. Now, herbs are probably one of the simplest things that you can grow, and you can get so many uses out of them, both culinary as well as medicinally. You can use those in all of your different foods, as we've talked about so many times in cooking. But the best way to do it, if you're not going to use fresh herbs and dealing with that, you want to go into the process of drying them. And there's a couple of things that you really need to think about before you even begin the process or the thought process of drying out your herbs. First off, whenever you're getting ready to harvest the herbs, you need to do it first thing in the morning after the dew is off. You don't want any moisture in the herbs. You don't want anything extra. So don't water and then harvest them. Get them first thing in the morning after the dew is off, and they'll be really, really perfect for harvesting. Secondly, you don't want any blooms on the herbs at the time that you're harvesting. Whenever you have bloom production, that also changes the flavor profile of the herb itself. So they can become bitter. You might have a little bit different taste than what you're used to versus the fresh herb that you're so commonly using during your cooking. So let's talk about when you're harvesting the herbs and transitioning into drying. So I've got rosemary here in front of me now. When you harvest the herbs, just cut off, just the sprigs as they come through. If it's the end of the season and you want to go ahead and cut the plant back, that's a great time to do that. But harvest one variety at a time and stage it for drying. That way you don't have herbs mixing up. So we're talking about rosemary. Rosemary and lavender are both kind of woody, traded features with good stems. So you want to harvest this and keep it intact. And I've got rosemary here that's bunched up together. You can use this, you can put the rubber band around it, or you can use twine and hang it from a hanger, but you want to put it in a good warm area that is out of sunlight, and that'll just hang. You want to hang them downwards. Same thing goes for lavender. If you're dealing with something like thyme, like I've got here, you see it's really just small leaves. This is going to be really common with basil, with mints, with oreganos, parsleys. Just get them all together as tight as you can and bunch them up. Now, being in the Southeast, one of the key things that we have to be concerned with is humidity. So It's going to take a little bit longer for the herbs to dry in our climate than it would somewhere maybe in the Northeast or the Midwest where there's not as much humidity. So allow enough time for the humidity to get out and that your herbs are going to be really dry. And you'll know when they're dry because you can just touch them and they're starting to break apart, most commonly like what you see in the grocery stores when you're purchasing dried herbs. Now, from this point, you've got several different options. The most traditional way of drying an herb is using a hanging option, and that's what we're talking about, putting it in a warm area where there's no sunlight and there's plenty of aeration and low moisture. Another option is to dry them in the oven. Now, when you're using the oven, the first thing you need to do is you need to set the oven on the lowest possible setting that you have. You want to spread the herbs out on a cookie sheet with the vented, that way the airflow can go through. And then on top of that, you want to crack the oven door. And the reason to crack the oven door is any moisture that steams out of the herbs as they've been cooking will escape through the doorway. So it's not a hot and fast procedure. It's more of a low and slow. So that's the best way if you don't want to use it and it's a little bit more time consuming, less time consuming rather, because it's only going to take 30 to 45 minutes versus several weeks. Now, another option, if you have a food dehydrator, you can take the herbs and throw them in the food dehydrator and do that process. You'll have to rotate the trays to get a good balance of dryness, but that will work out for you in the long run. If you want to find the steps out of how to dry herbs in your home, go to bonnieplants.com and check out our how to grow section.
Now, if you have a gardening question, drop Sydney an email at simplysouthern@alafarm.com. and he may answer it on an upcoming show. You can also go to their website, bonnieplants.com, for gardening tips, recipes, and much more. We're out of time for today. Thanks for joining us, and we hope you'll be back with us next week when we'll check in with a 16-year-old trying to get his license, but not in Dad's car.
And we'll visit the place voted the best catfish restaurant in Alabama. But before we go, here are links to some of the stories we featured today. I'm Jim Allen.
And I'm Mary Johnson. We'll see you back here again next week.
Simply Southern is a production of the Alabama Farmers Cooperative and the Alabama Farmers Federation.